Hi everyone, and welcome back to Physics 26 Street Astronomy. This is section 9 where we're going to be talking about star formation, essentially the processes leading to stars existing, and also to the final stages of stars. And this builds up on what we covered in section 8, where we discussed main sequence stars. As always, you'll find all the details in the lecture notes, including even further explanations and those that I'm giving in these videos. Very briefly, these are the contents of section 9. We're going to be starting with star formation and the conditions you need for stars to form, and also looking at typical regions where stars form. We'll see they are incredibly dusty. They're not so easy to see. We're also going to see that when stars form, they don't form at all masses equally, and there's many more stars that form at low masses than those that form with high masses. And we're also going to explore star clusters as sort of laboratories to have a look at how stars evolve, essentially away from the main sequence. Finally, we'll see that essentially mass will determine the fate of a star, and the most massive stars will very likely evolve into a neutron star or a black hole after they go supernova, while stars like the sun and lower mass, if anything, they'll only go to a red giant phase before they contract back and ultimately lead to a planetary nebulae and also a white dwarf. Imagine that we get ourselves some telescope or some nice telescopes and we start surveying the solar neighborhood and essentially trying to count how many stars there are in this local volume as a function of, for example, the absolute magnitude of a star. If we do that, we realize that there's not that many bright stars, that the sun, stars like the sun, are actually quite common, but that stars which are even fainter than the sun are even more common. Now, when we do something like this, we're essentially looking at the end product of stars. So perhaps the reason why very luminous stars are rare is because they evolve out of the main sequence and they disappear. So what about their formation? We'll come back to essentially a plot like this that gives you the relative number of stars as a function of stellar mass. But it's important to point out already that even when stars form, there's only a few that will form with very high masses and many that will form with masses even below the sun. This is called the initial mass function. It essentially tells you about the relative number of stars as a function of stellar mass at the moment of formation, but as we shall see, because the main sequence lifetimes of massive stars are way shorter than those at low masses, it also means that this initial mass function becomes truncated at higher masses as time goes on, and this truncation actually shifts to lower and lower masses. The initial mass function essentially describes the number of stars per stellar mass when stars are born. It can be given as a single power law with an exponent alpha. Sometimes, and this is important just to point out, the initial mass function can be described as a combination of two power laws. And this is the example that you see here in this figure. In order to reproduce it, you would actually need two power laws, not a single one. But for most applications in 263, we will focus on describing the relative number of stars per mass, essentially as something that will depend on a constant times mass to a power of alpha. With the same framework, we'll see that we can actually describe the amount of mass per mass essentially by multiplying phi, our relative number of stars per mass, by mass. And we'll see the exact details, how we can very easily calculate these integrals and how to apply it in practice. For now, it is already important to just realize that either when we look at the end product, when stars form, or even if we look at the moment of creation, stars with very low masses are very common, stars with very high stellar masses are very rare.